Hi, I'm Morgan Davis, Associate Editor at NexChange, and I'm here today at the annual Schroeder's Media Conference talking with some of the portfolio managers about industry trends and what we can see in the markets today. So I know that we've talked a lot about differing monetary policies globally, and that's had a huge impact on investors and what we're looking at. What exactly is going on right now as far as how investors are looking at their investments and portfolios now, and what could this mean a little bit down the road for them?
The monetary policy is an interesting question because in one sense, you've got the US where we clearly expect them to raise rates this year, but that's within market expectations as well, versus in Europe where we're seeing QE and they've told us they're going to see the program through. But as we've seen in the last 10 days, 2 weeks, market sentiment seems to have changed dramatically on the sustainability of the QE program to keep bond yields over there low. For us, from a multi-sector perspective, within portfolios, what we're trying to do is build sufficient liquidity in all of our portfolios across strategies so that if there is a kind of dislocation, and liquidity is the one thing that doesn't match really in the market at the moment. It's not the same liquidity that there was, but the size of the markets, the size of investors has ballooned. We want a portfolio that can take advantage of any gaps in liquidity. Aside from that, at the current environment, it's not a time to be a hero.
And where does the multi-sector approach fit in with that? Is now the time that investors should be looking at that type of approach?
We think the danger with forecasting market reactions to, say, a potential Fed move is that you're nearly always wrong. People have been forecasting Fed rate rises for many years now. The muni market in 2013 kind of exaggerated the end of QE into moving the Fed, and here we are 2 years later and they still haven't moved. Clearly, at the short end, that can really impact, Fed policy can really impact markets at the short end. But the long end, it may be much more to do with, say, insurance company demand or pension plan demand that's going to drive valuations. What we want to do is when sentiment changes, which for me, sentiment is arguably more important than what the Fed actually does. It's what they do versus expectations, how that impacts sentiment in the market, where we need to be in a position to react. I used a word earlier today, pivotable, which apparently is a real word, I checked. And what we want is sufficient risk in the portfolio that we can maintain some kind of exposure to markets, because valuations aren't so bad. It's just whether valuations compensate you sufficiently now for this declined liquidity. And then the natural extension of that is to build a portfolio with a reasonable amount of liquidity that when other investors who are kind of pushing risk as aggressive as they can to hit their latest performance target, when they're forced sellers, be it because of mutual fund flows or investor redemptions, we're beginning to see it already perhaps in Europe following the recent moves that some fund redemptions are coming through. We want to be in a position that we have the liquidity to take advantage of those forced sellers. We did it in 2013 in the muni market, we did it in 2011 in the muni market, and we did it at the end of last year in the energy sector when there's nothing that we like more than a forced seller.
And talking about the investor sentiment, as you mentioned, is it easy to get ahead of that? How do you look at investor sentiment?
It's not easy to get ahead of it, clearly. What we're trying to do is build a portfolio that has sufficient liquidity that we can take advantage of it if and when it happens, because there's no guarantee it's going to happen, and there's certainly no guarantee on the timing, but at the same time, maintain sufficient risk in the portfolio that we can get a reasonable return for our investors. So it's that balance, and that's the hard part of the job. Sentiment is incredibly flaky. Right now, the corporate new issue market seems to be flying. We've got every single day multi-billion dollar deals coming in the dollar market. But eventually, there'll be some fatigue in that. And when that first deal fails or doesn't perform as people expect, that will have an enormous impact on sentiment, even though fundamentally nothing's actually changed.
And I know that we've talked a lot about Puerto Rican munis, and that's a hot topic with some very high-profile investors lately. And you had some great comments about that this morning. Can you tell us a little bit about what your thoughts on that area?
Yeah, I mean, I would caveat this in that we invest in the higher quality end of the spectrum, so we don't typically go into triple C rated securities. One of the issues we have with Puerto Rico, which is why we have no exposure, is that there's $73 billion worth of debt there, and we don't think that's sustainable. And unlike in a situation with a corporate default, where there's very clear mechanisms and recovery values that you can try and estimate, when you get into a sovereign or quasi-sovereign, I'm not sure how best to describe Puerto Rico, the rules change, and the rules are different each and every time. And the one word of caution is, if just Google Greek debt haircut, and you'll see the magnitude of some of the the haircuts that private investors took in the Greek restructuring. And interestingly, it was only the private investors. It didn't impact some of the other investors. It wasn't an event of default for CDS. And here we are, I think the first haircut was in 2011. Here we are in 2015, and Greece is still a problem. And so the idea that it's just a yield game, we think it's more than that. And we, personally, I don't feel we have the expertise to evaluate that. It doesn't for one moment mean that other people don't. So I'm not, don't want to get into any kind of disagreement, but we're on the higher quality spectrum, mm-hmm. and it's not really the kind of area that we play in.
Sure, understandable. Well, thanks so much for being here with us today.
Thank you. Bye.